right, hello everyone. Today we are here with artist Leah Netsky. She is an exhibiting artist in Harmony Art and Music at the Piano Factory, which is our current exhibition, organized by Frederica King and curated by myself and Eric Rao. So Leah has a number of works on view here. She has six total works on view. So these four light boxes behind us, and then two viewing boxes throughout the gallery from her series Holographic, which combines photo, video, and sound. So thank you so much for joining us today. I appreciate your time, and I'm very excited to have this discussion.
Yeah, excited.
Wonderful. So to start off, I'm gonna start with a hard hitting question. I'm very interested to hear what was one of your first significant experiences with art, you know, something you might remember from your childhood or something that encouraged you to begin creating.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I guess like the first thing that kind of came to mind was in high school taking my first art room class, which was like a big kind of transformative moment for me. But specifically, I remember the first time that I saw, like, that I developed a role film and kind of saw the image show up. And so that was kind of this magical moment, and I have a lot of kind of memories tied to, you know, like the smell of the chemistry and kind of like the mix CD that was playing in the classroom, probably like Radiohead or Coldplay or something. But I feel like that was a very kind of like transformative moment. And also just kind of the space that the photo classroom slash like dark room created. It was like a place for everybody to kind of hang out, and I guess it was kind of my first like artist community that I was part of. So yeah, that's kind of what I thought of.
That's wonderful. Do you remember what was on that first roll of film?
You know what? I'm sure that some of the images didn't, you know, like the first roll you develop doesn't always come out that great. I think it may have been portraits of my friend. I don't think all of them are like perfect, but it was just seeing that image show up.
Yeah.
It's like you kind of are doing the whole process and you're like, is this really gonna, you know, feel so disconnected from, and then you see it actually show up.
It's right. Really, it's kind of this magical.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's really wonderful. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
So speaking of that, I'd love to get into a little bit of your background in the arts.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of how, you know, going from developing what was in the dark room, just doing photography, how that kind of evolved into this type of work.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Sure. So basically, yeah, my background's mostly in just normal photography, though I was kind of always interested in using the image as kind of material to create something larger. And I've always been kind of, I've been really into, I guess one of my biggest influences is Wolfgang Tillmans, who's a German photographer who does a lot of really big installation pieces with photography. So he'll print them with all different sizes and put them, and then kind of contrast subject matter as well. So I've kind of always been interested in kind of how the context that you present an image in defines how it's interpreted. And using it kind of as an installation material. So then in grad school, I started working with making light boxes. I felt like it was a good way to kind of elevate an image and make it to more of an object. And also the subject matter I was working with, I was doing a lot of work about mass production and the meat slash food industry. So light boxes conceptually felt like a good fit for kind of referencing advertising. So it felt like a good fit for that subject matter. And again, kind of always thinking about how like the context you're presenting an image can change how it's interpreted. So that was, I think, my first experience where I was actually making light boxes. And then I did use sound in a video. Like, I hadn't done much sound work. I did sound in one video that I was making called Meat Stacks, which was also kind of about the meat industry and mass production. And so for that video, I used classical music that I had sped up and put in reverse to kind of give it like a chaotic feel.
Yeah.
So that was my first use of, like, I guess, sound, really. So then, let's see, what was next? So then basically, I started doing essentially what led to this project. So I took, a lot of my projects kind of start with a strange association. intention. That's like how I think of my work kind of sometimes starts. So basically in this project I was looking at birds on a wire and thinking about how they reminded me of notes on a musical score. And so I took photographs of a bunch of birds on wires and made it into a score, and then I had my dad, I guess it's he was one of the people in this project, and one of my friends, Mia Friedman, who's also in this project, interpret it. So I had them both do like different interpretations of the score. And that got me thinking about kind of converting other types of patterns to graphic scores. So I was kind of thinking like, you know, birds are more of like a solid, they don't look like a musical score, but it's more like they're really on the staff. So I kind of wanted to play with what if I put images that had color and texture and shape with musical scores. So I was thinking about things like fairies, bubbles, and different kinds of patterns. And so I started just giving them to musicians to interpret, and that's how this project came to be. So yeah, this is really my biggest project with sound, but that's kind of how I got to both of those types of works. Yeah.
Wow, great. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned your father and your friend Mia were part of this project.
Yes.
So they were some of your collaborators for this.
They were a really big part of it.
Yeah, I'd love to hear more about that and the collaboration process as a
for
whole.
For sure. Yeah, so basically, I think I mentioned also in the panel when we were talking, I think a really big part of the collaborative process for this particular project was the fact that the musicians were literally just like interpreting these scores completely live. Like they had never seen them before. So that was really cool because, well, obviously it shows that they're very incredible that they can kind of do that. But I think it's really cool too because I think sometimes in creativity it's kind of helpful to almost have a little bit of structure but then be able to experiment. So I think it's kind of a cool combination of them having a lot of the people in that particular department I was working with at the conservatory, they're from the contemporary improvisation department, so they have a lot of kind of classical training but are very experimental. So kind of this ability to experiment within structure, and I think that kind of made them good fits for this project. But I also think it was really cool to have them interpreting these scores live. And then, as I was kind of mentioned a little bit, a lot of my work is about kind of subconscious association. So in the musicians' performances, you're seeing these musicians' like raw, unfiltered reactions to these graphic scores, which I like. So you're kind of getting these moments where maybe sometimes it looks more polished, and then other times they're kind of like making a weird face, or kind of you can see their reactions more raw. So
So you're referencing the videos in
the live boxes.
And the viewing boxes. So those are videos of the live interpretation.
Exactly.
Very interesting.
Exactly. Yeah, so then for the project I wanted to include both like pieces where you can really see what the scores looked like. Like this is what some of them, there were much more than this, but just here's what some of them looked like.
Yeah.
But then I also wanted to have some of those actual performances because they're really interesting, I think, to be able to see them performing live. Yeah.
Definitely. Mm-hmm. So you talked a little bit about subconscious association.
Yeah.
And interpretation. Uh-huh. So I'm wondering, maybe you can give us your perspective on how a viewer's interpretation of these images, or their connection to Christmas lights or pie or something, would kind of affect the way that they experience this work. Mm-hmm.
So basically, so my work in general is about trying to kind of encourage subconscious association in the viewer. I mentioned that a little bit.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to quickly like explain. So I have synesthesia, which is, you might have heard of, but it's basically like the involuntary pairing of two or more senses. A lot of people have it. But my specific one is mostly with people's names and foods, tastes and textures.
Interesting.
Just a weird little side thing. But I think from that there's that specific way it manifests, but then it also kind of in my work makes me think almost like comparisons, like these weird, like the bird wire comparison. It's like just kind of how, I don't know, how my brain thinks, I think.
Right.
But so I feel like, a big part of my work is wanting to kind of encourage the viewer to have these sense associations. Because I think everybody has these types of weird, you know, memories and associations, but I think sometimes society
watching the musicians.
Exactly.
On the spot.
Exactly. Right, like there's moments where you kind of, I feel like for a second, you'll see them playing. And
yeah.
There's one part where Juyeon is like plucking her instrument and it kind of almost like sounds like plucking berries off of the bush.
Right.
Like there's these moments where it kind of lines up and I want people to kind of have those moments where for them it's connecting.
So, right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So thinking about like your practice as a whole or maybe current bodies of work,
mm-hmm.
do you see this work and like the influence of sound kind of showing up in that as well and kind of steering you in a new direction or a similar direction?
Mm-hmm.
Like are you still like, working with
like sound? Like what I want to continue to do?
Yeah.
I guess like I definitely want to continue. I kind of see my work in two different avenues,
mm-hmm.
but I mean I think there's relations between this and my other work, but I definitely am still doing a lot of work about kind of mass production and the food industry. But I want to continue with this project because I think there's a lot of potential to continue working with musicians and keep kind of making scores and having them, you know, interpret and do live performances as well.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I want to continue to work with this project specifically, I think,
wonderful.
As well.
Yeah, that would be great to see it
mm-hmm.
expand.
Mm-hmm.
And in talking about, you know, your influences and, you know, where you're going with your art.
Yeah.
I want to talk a little bit about if you feel that your work as an arts educator and also
mm-hmm.
your work with Historic New England is influencing your current work at all, or has in the past.
For sure. So, yeah, I mean, I think there are ways that it's influenced my work. I think mostly it just made me really kind of get good at technique, mm-hmm. certain techniques. And I think with teaching, it's helped that I've taught like a few different types of courses. Darkroom, digital, Photoshop. So it's like for each one, I kind of had to get good at knowing the techniques for each one. But then with Historic New England, same thing. It's like, it's just, I think it's just helping me to learn a lot of the like, technical things. And like, for example, at Historic New England, I'm a collections photographer. So a lot of the things I'm like learning how to standardize an image, make it kind of consistent from image to image, make it really look like what it's supposed to be an image. Like not embellish it. You know,
right.
If you're taking a photo of a page in a book, it really needs to look exactly like what that page looks like.
Right.
But also I've been doing a lot of work recently at Historic New England with 3D imaging techniques. So I've been doing a lot of 3D scanning of spaces, which has been really cool. And so I think that has a lot of potential for something. Like in the past I've done 3D printing and modeling in my work. And I definitely want to like continue to incorporate into new works.
Yeah,
so I'm excited about getting to kind of use certain technologies at my job that I think we probably have access to
otherwise.
It's pretty cool. So,
yeah, no, that's really fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
I would love to see the connection between that and like,
yeah,
working together.
For sure.
Yeah.
Or just like, because there it's like I'm doing, you know, I'm doing scanning a property, which is very cool, but I think there's other objects you can scan in that way.
Right.
Ways to,
so we talked about this a little bit the other day in a panel discussion that you were a part of.
Yeah.
But one thing that we're really trying to highlight with the Harmony exhibition mm-hmm. is the history of the Piano Craft Guild, where the Piano Craft Gallery is housed.
Yeah.
As it was once a piano factory
mm-hmm.
and then converted to subsidized artist housing. And the artists living here during the time period are subsidized, they experience certain benefits that they don't experience anymore. But despite this, there remains like a large community of artists who live and work in the building.
Yeah,
that's
super cool.
Exactly, yeah,
mm-hmm.
it's really wonderful. So we're trying to bring that to light with this exhibition
mm-hmm.
And talk about community through that. So I'm wondering where you find your artist community.
So I guess my artist community, a lot of the people, I guess, in my artist community are from where I went to grad school. I think that plays a big part in what ends up being your artist community.
Yeah.
So for me, that's, I went to Tucson, Arizona, so way, but I try to still kind of keep in touch with everybody, and sometimes we still try to collaborate. imagery on the cover.
Wonderful. Thank you all for being here and watching.
Thank you.